Hello everyone, PinkHusky here again, and we will be continuing our playthrough of Kona. So this is the second episode. Let's go ahead. So we were at the general store, and then went over to Gilles Lachance's house, though I had no more fire starter. So we couldn't actually get ourselves warm again. So, probably because of the auto saving, it's gonna be like some kind of a backtrack, so to speak. Yep. Let's see. Okay. Now, what do we have inventory wise? Equipment. Okay. Consumables. Yeah, no more fire starter, looks like it. Inventory. Got plenty of matches, but. Yeah, and if I do recall correctly, there was no longer any more fire starter around here. Oh well, we'll take a different route for now. We'll try and follow these tracks. All right. Right. Let's see if there's something in the hot house. Nope. We got ourselves another iceberg here. Let's take a picture. Yep. Looks like it's heading that way. Okay, still see the tracks. Another one. All right. What have we got here? That's for sure. A wolf wouldn't be able to bend a rifle like that. Let's take a picture. Almost sounded like there was a wolf around. All right. Let's check this out. All of a sudden, Carl felt he was pulled inside a world of old, unknown dimension. Somehow, self-control was slipping from his grasp. To all appearance, this was a hunting book, and again, a war diary. Mister's Journal, page 1. The beast enjoys long slumbers. Its sanctuary seems impregnable. Ice is everywhere. I need to exercise patience and wait for it to come out. To think like a hunter. The beast often invades the settlements bordering the lake. It terrorizes the white people. They never see it coming, but they feel its presence, a cold dread grabbing at your innards. The beast excites the wolf, makes them more aggressive. One attacked me, I had to cut his throat. The blade dig into his flesh, made the sound of a taut wire. The beast is getting closer. to the villagers. It moves at night, bring heavy snow and strong gusts of wind. Along with it, I tracked it to no avail. I do not know the white man frozen in ice, but I do know this. It is the work of the beast. It attacks curdle the blood of its victim. White men know nothing of the force of this force of nature. I touched their eyes, imprisoning the white man. I saw things, but I do not understand them. It was as if past and present were one, or as if I was a spider, and with my eight eyes, I could see backward and forward simultaneously. This beast, this creature, is not of this world. I must find the beast again, and if necessary, eliminate it. Alright. A few more tracks. Seven, three, nine. Here's apparently the white man, the hunter that we probably saw earlier. Who can it be? Oh, see the truck that we saw earlier. Alright, so now we know who was the unlucky one. Let's go back to the general store and warm up a bit. Or did we unlock this? Nope. All right, so let's take our truck, but instead of stopping over at La Chance, we'll probably go further, try to find some fire starter. Or I could go north. Yeah, let's go northwest west. It'll be I might find some fire starter over there. And also probably get access to something which can be very, very useful. Because as you saw at the beginning of the game, basically, we were like during maybe fall. And right now there's snow everywhere. So Most likely our tire, as you can see, seems a little bit light. I haven't checked if there was a mailbox over there. Nope. Alright. It's up the stairs. Wait. I'm just gonna grab something first. The empty bottle. Oh, I have one fire starter here. Well. Let's try and find more. Dr. Beaupré. More fire starter, nice. Let's see. Note. Yeah, probably will never happen. Doctor's note. Medical emergency in town. The doctor there is sick. I'll be back soon. If he dies, I won't be returning. I'll have to replace him. Isabelle Beaupré. That was the photo we've actually got from the car at the beginning. Nice, another fire starter. Two matches. Let's fill the empty bottle with water. There you go. Not in here. Right. Not a med kit, first aid kit. Communist manifest. The history of all hitherto existing society is the history of class struggles. Freeman and slave, patrician and plebeian, lord and serf, guildmaster and journeyman, in a word, oppressor and oppressed, stood in constant opposition to one another, carried on an uninterrupted, now hidden, now open fight. A fight that each time ended either in a revolutionary reconstruction of society at large, or in the common ruin of the contending classes. In the earlier epochs of history, we find almost everywhere a complicated arrangement of society into various orders, a manifold gradation of social rank. In ancient Rome, we have patricians, knights, plebeian, slaves. In the Middle Ages, feudal lords, basal, guild masters, journeymen, apprentices, serfs. In almost all of these classes, again, subordinate gradation. No, I want a flashlight. Here. Painkiller. Université de Montréal, which is a real university. Doctors use light reflecting frontal mirrors to look inside the patient's cavity. That was a bit unsettling, but back then, it was pretty much always the case. Unknown woman. I never did quite catch her name. The men called her Lore. She had an egg wound. There was so much blood. The bullet had done a lot of damage, probably hitting the cerebellum. It was hopeless. She had a cardiac arrest. The men had found her like this, they said. I doubt it, but in a small town like this, it's usually the best to turn a blind eye. I've been told to step back from sending out the death certificate. This whole thing sickens me. Rosa Arma. No medical explanation whatsoever can explain why old Rosa is still alive. As we in the trade say, the only way to cure him is to kill him. Sylvie Bedard. All of her symptoms point to the same root cause. She's pregnant. She refuses it. She denies it. I'm willing to bet her husband is not the father. Let's just hope it's not Everett Lockhart, though, or she would have an illegitimate child and a syphilis on her hands. There was no doubt that the doctor and Hamilton knew each other very well. William Joseph Hamilton, basically the one who actually hired you. RD, can be cured. Chronic foot pain, can't walk long distance. Rich, I'll cure him of that one day. Well, I guess someone took care of that. Nobody kills a rich patient with a murder again. It didn't make any sense. He had to think people's will to what he had. Luckily, that was Carl Colbert's spectrum. The injured could be recognized by the large stains of his name, an informal nickname given to murder on the smudge all over their injury. Alright, I guess that's about it around here. No special iceberg around here. Don't see any wolf tracks either. Oh, no, now we do. Right.
Carl felt like he knew his stuff. His belongings had spoken lightness about it. But what Carl had heard was the weakness.
Okay, they continue here. Right here. I don't really gotta find those tracks, especially I'll even the birds chirping. Somewhat gives it a hairy feel. Oh, was that a squirrel? Let's head back. Let's warm up a bit before returning to the truck. Duct tape. All right. Let's continue. Further west. All right, I don't want to go there right now. You'll see why later. Just want to go and fetch something first. Oh. Let's take a picture of that. Yep. There's no wolf track though, but let's go ahead and check. Okay. All right. Two wolves. Were they the same one that we saw over at the store? Yeah, looks like it went in there. But right now, we'll come back later. We got another one right here. Well, looks like we're on the right track. Our body temperature is still dropping. All right. How's the Patriot?
Which had resurfaced in 1970 in Quebec, flown counter by the Empire's U carrier. This had been bombed, kidnapped, wrecked in the paper. It was a sign of rebellion.
So, yes, back in the 70s, 60s, 70s, there was a movement called the FLQ, or Front de Libération du Québec, which basically translates to Quebec Liberation Front, that did terrorist acts. They wanted Quebec to be separate from... So yeah, so they did some bombings, also a kidnapping of Pierre Laporte, who was a minister for the Quebec government, if I do recall correctly. Just give me a moment. We'll be able to warm up soon. Ah, now why did I chew it away? I wanted to keep it.
The place looked more like a pigsty than a house. A heavy stench of little turf, cheap alcohol, boiled cauliflower, filled the air.
So, yeah, they did a kidnapping, and also back in the 70s, if I do recall correctly, it was Robert Bourassa who was the Quebec Prime Minister, and he actually asked Pierre Elliott Trudeau, Justin Trudeau, is the current Prime Minister. Pierre Elliott Trudeau was his father, and he was the Prime Minister of Canada back then. He asked Pierre Elliott Trudeau to enact martial law due to that terrorist group. Yeah, because you got clean dishes, you know, you don't need to do your other dishes. Nothing in there. Empty gun rack. Drawers are overrated, yeah, by leaving everything. Sure looks like it. So, yep, caribou is an alcoholic beverage, especially in Quebec. Nowadays, maybe you're gonna be seeing this a little bit during some winter festival, but it's not really been drank anymore. So white whiskey, too much isn't a valid quantifier for that. Sherry wine for added mellowness, spices to taste, just a tiny bit. This is in stew. So we did get the sherry wine earlier, and let's see. I don't have an empty bottle. Is that why? Darn. Let's go ahead and check around. See if I can find an empty bottle. Matches, nothing. A beer. Yeah, it's not too bad. Yeah, at least got one bullseye. Am I missing something? No, not this. This. There's nothing. Beer bottle. I don't need it. Oh. Crowbar still over at in the garage. So the sherry wine is probably over there in the general store. Well, let's head back there. So yeah, we'll be heading back. Well, I should check my inventory first. Inventory. Sherry wine. No, I got it. Consumable water bottle. But yeah, I need an empty bottle then. All right, probably won't need to go all the way back to, well, except for the crowbar, which I can go later. Right here. Alright, Kozai's house. Smoke coming out of the smokestack. Let's check this first. Fire starter. It's locked. All right. It looks like, yeah, there's someone inside. Nothing in there. So, well, I wonder if he's still alive. Looks like it. But you may never know. Probably, you know, he probably died sitting down. Now he's looking at me, and looks like he's holding a rifle, therefore he seems very much alive. Oh. Let's close this. So basically he wants us to bring him caribou, which is the alcoholic beverage that I've talked earlier. But let's check some stuff. Yeah, but right now you should stop pointing at that towards the door. Okay, here's one of the empty bottles. Talking about yourself, old man. All right, let's talk to him a bit. Almost sounds like another legend or something. Probably that's why there was a ban, I do believe, in Quebec called the Parabole. Oh my god, my diaper. Well, yeah, nowadays, you know, we can look at Facebook while, while we're in the toilet. tales and legends. There was a time when a hate waged war. Our hunters could dismay the great wolves who had taken our children. Our warriors could snap the necks of the cowards when we reached for our supplies. The deafening sound of rock and bone breaking was enough to satiate the hate, and the rivers of blood would express our remorse and apologies. Thus was balance maintained. Then came the whites. The legend of the Wendigo dates back to a time before what anyone but the tallest trees can remember, a time of great cold. A time of great cold and great aspiration, when the ships came and spewed men and their fire cannons plague, and spineless balance broke forever. The dead were piling up on our ancestral lands, too many bodies covered in moss, too much blood spilled on our stone. Our bone-breaking hate did not suffice any longer. One day a young warrior who had lost everything, nieces, brothers, parents, and hope, fell to his knees in the middle of a small clearing covered in blood of his fiancée, killed after having crossed the path of some whites passing by. He had seen everything and called out to the Great Spirit, called out to him with words that came so naturally to him, words that could only create a great river of blood and guts. Of blood and guts, and a terrifying roar and screams. He called out to him for a force that no one had had before. He became Wendigo. The wise waters made it under the icy claws of the Wendigo. A great tide of blood even pushed a few ships back out to sea, but man, he should stop interrupting me. You know, keep quiet. But the Wendigo was not yet done with his vengeance, for as long as the art of his of one of his fiancée's murderers still beat on Cree territory, he would prevail. Will he talk right now? The elder says said that it was a force of the ancestors' return to nature that turned the young warrior. In this clearing where many ancestors have been buried in centuries past, a clearing now covered in blood spilled unjustly, in a time where too many bodies were being buried, the ancestors heard the cries of the young warrior, only in a remarkable time like... only in a remarkable time like this could the Wendigo have been born. His vengeance satiated, the warrior become Wendigo, when the rest forever his frozen heart melted and disappeared, much like real snow come the spring. The storm that had befallen the Cree lands faded as well. There was much celebration, balance had been restored, but the whites came back too. With hatred is never satisfied by rock and bone turned to dust, they arrived by the hundreds, armed with guns and torches, burn down every village, rape every woman, smash the head of every newborn, tortured every man that fell into their grips. Never before had unbalance been so deep for the Cree people. And ever since, it has been told that one should be satisfied with the rivers of blood brought by hatred despite the wrongfulness done to them, because remarkable aid comes at far too steep a price. The Wendigo was never invoked again, but in the hearts of the Cree people remain a fear that one day a young warrior would once again call out with remarkable aid, because they know through the wisdom brought by this legend that the Wendigo would prevail, but that this victory would come at a great cost. The whites would come back, the whites would rule, no one would be spared. And this picture looks like one of the myths called La Chasse Galerie. All right. So we got an empty bottle. So I do believe we'll be able to go ahead and mix that caribou. But let's check this out first. Okay, lantern. Empty gas can might be useful. So nothing in there. All right, let's go back to the pasture's house. Let's go in. Let's go and make that caribou to go and get the coat. I'll be able to stay out longer. All right, not too far here. All right. Yes. So now we have caribou, and we'll go and see Rosai, the old man that we have just met. Another caribou will keep him probably a little bit happy and warm, so to speak. Because caribou is told to be very strong. Don't want to crash into the trees. Let's talk to Omen Rosario. I'm not even your house right now. Yeah, I have it. So as you can see, we got the jacket. We also got warmer pants other than jeans and some boots. All right, well, this will be it for today. See you all later.